Welcome everyone to the 18th meeting of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee in 2022. I've received no apologies for today's meeting. And the first item on our agenda is to decide whether to take items 4 and 5 in private. Are members agreed? We're agreed, thank you. And our second item today is an evidence session with the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care. And this follows a previous evidence session with stakeholders from the social care sector on the 22nd of February this year. It focused on addressing the current challenges facing the social care sector, as highlighted by Audit Scotland's briefing on social care. So I welcome to the committee Kevin Stewart, the Minister for Mental Wellbeing and Social Care. Good morning, Minister. And the Minister is accompanied by his officials, Gillian Barclay, Deputy Director for Resilience and Pressures Unit, and Donna Bell, Director for Social Care and the National Care Service Development, both from the Scottish Government. Good morning to you as well. Minister, I believe you have an opening statement.
I do, thank you, Convener, and good morning to you and good morning to the committee. As you'll be aware, Audit Scotland recognised that our commitment to a National Care Service indicates our recognition of the significant challenge within social care in Scotland. Indeed, the findings of the report were largely in line with the Independent Review of Adult Social Care led by Derek Feely, which is precisely why we are acting now to further increase investment in social care and deliver a national care service by the end of this Parliament. I am clear, though, Convener, that we should not wait to establish the National Care Service in order to take action where it is needed. As such, the Scottish Government will increase public investment in social care by 25% over this Parliament, so that by the end of the Parliament, we will have budgeted over £800 million of increased annual support for social care compared to current spending. In the latest programme for government, we restarted our commitment to transformative social care reform, including developing options for the removal of non-residential charging for adult social care. In addition, I've committed to invest £50 million over the life of this Parliament to support the regulation and development of the social services workforce through the Scottish Social Services Council. For unpaid carers, the Scottish Government announced an additional £4 million to help organisations working with unpaid carers to put expanded services in place. Other more immediate action that I'm happy to take questions on include support for the workforce to address recruitment and retention issues, and work underway to develop the healthcare framework for adults living in care homes in Scotland. For these interim steps, as well as the National Care Service establishment, we're committed to listening to the voices of lived experience. Conversations with those with lived experience are already informing our review of self-directed support. Keeping those with lived experience at the heart of our decision-making will help us shape a system which improves future services and makes things better for everyone. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Minister, and thanks for that summary. It's preempting, I suppose, my first line of questioning on the pace of implementation of things that are going to address some of the difficulties that have been highlighted by our colleagues and stakeholders when we spoke to them. And one of the things that I'm interested in, though, you outlined, obviously, there's a work going on in the National Care Service. Obviously, we're not at the draft point of that bill yet, and we appreciate that you won't be able to talk about that until it's published. So there's the resourcing element of, there's the formulation and the work that's going to be going on, obviously, to respond to the consultation, to formulate the bill, and then, of course, once it goes through Parliament, actually setting up the National Care Service. But on the other hand, there's all the things that you've outlined in terms of the actions that you're taking now. And I just wonder if you can tell me about the resourcing of both. I mean, I guess that people want to know that both are going to be fully resourced and that it's not going to be a case of resources been taken away from the things that you're saying that have been targeting issues now into the development of the National Care Service. I wonder if you can give me some thoughts on that.
Convener, this is challenging. There's absolutely no doubt about it. There is a lot going on within the social care sector. And I'm very lucky in terms of the team that I have, headed up by Donna Bell, which Gillian Barclay is part of as well, in terms of what they are doing at present. And they recognise, like I do, that we can't wait for the National Care Service to make some of the change that's required. That means that we are having to do a lot of work, a lot of it at pace, to try and ensure that we are doing our level best for people in the here and now, as well as formulating what change is required for the future. So, for example, Gillian, on a day and daily basis, is looking at the pressures that are on social care right across the country, is involved in the Gold Group that works fortnightly, is involved with the Cabinet Secretary and I in terms of our discussions with health and social care partnerships, NHS boards and local authorities in order that we improve the current situation. The committee will be well aware of the pressures that are out there at this moment in time. You know, we're not trying to hide from the fact that there are pressures out there. And what we are doing, what the Cabinet Secretary and I are doing, what the team are doing, are trying to ensure that the best practice that is going on out there is exported across the country. We are giving help and advice where we can to health and social care partnerships, boards and local authorities in order to meet the challenge that there most definitely is. Convener, I've said previously in front of the committee that, you know, we are at a precarious time in the pandemic. Lots of folk think that the pandemic period is over, but there are still huge pressures in terms of the workforce. Still folks off with COVID lessening, and thank goodness for that. But there are other pressures that are on the go at this moment in time. And we are doing our best to be helpful to alleviate some of those pressures so we can get back to some kind of normality. So a huge amount going on at this moment in time. As I say, I'm very lucky to have the team that I have in government. They are very, very active, has to be said. And we will continue to work at pace, not only on the formulation of the National Care Service, but in terms of the reinvigoration as we recover from the pandemic.
You mentioned listening to the voices of lived experience, and I know initially you were talking about in terms of the formulation of the National Care Service, but you also said that you've listened to the voices of lived experience right now. What are those voices telling you about what needs to be done right now?
So let's take, for example, a call that I had yesterday with disabled people's organisations, folks from the independent living movement and folks with lived experience of disability. Now, while a lot of the conversation yesterday was about National Care Service and how we move forward, it has to be said that folk do talk about the here and now because that's relevant to them. And, you know, a large part of yesterday's discussion was not about National Care Service per se, but a lot of folk were discussing the difficulties that they currently have in certain parts of Scotland accessing self-directed support. Now, the committee knows that there's a bit of a postcode lottery there at this moment, where in some parts of Scotland, the options available to people are restricted, which does not really conform to the Act itself or the spirit of the Act. And, you know, we are at this moment reviewing the guidance of self-directed support to make it easier and more understandable for people to access what is their right. So that's just one example from yesterday, which wasn't a focus on National Care Service, but a focus on the here and now. And as the committee is aware, we're currently reviewing that guidance in order to improve the law for people.
I was going to ask you about self-directed support because that's something that is obviously, you know, your constituency, and you speak to people who have carers coming in or have care needs. That's one of the things that mentioned. Just before I allow Callum Walken to come in, I just wanted to mention something that was mentioned to me around self-directed support by one of my constituents when I was doing a bit of a street surgery. And she made a really good point, and she said, the self-directed support is for me because I'm the one that, you know, I've got mobility issues, but I'm a mum and I'm a wife and I'm, you know, I have a family around me, but that support seems to be only targeted at me, and it's like my meal will get made and that's, you can't do anything else for anyone else. But if I were able, I would be doing this stuff as well. Is that something that you're hearing as well, almost that kind of whole family approach? I mean, that's, it seems to me a bit of dignity in there as well.
You hear a lot of different stories, convener, around about where it works and where it doesn't for an individual or their families. And, you know, I think that some of the flexibilities that were in play during the pandemic, we have to look at to see if they should be embedded as we move forward. You know, I have heard stories of transformational change for individuals and families with self-directed support. At the same time, you know, there are other cases where maybe that support has not gone far enough in terms of meeting the needs of the person that requires the support. One of the great things about this job for me is the ability to talk, unfortunately, not very often yet face-to-face, but online with people around about what works and what doesn't. And it is quite amazing when you hear where SDS has made a real difference in the law, not just only for the individual who is being supported, but also for the family as a whole. Now, those kind of stories are the ones that we should be aspiring to as we move forward, instead of the situation that we have at the moment, which is still a bit of a postcode lottery, to say the least, in terms of the delivery of support and services for some.
Thank you. Carol, you have some questions.
Hey, thank you. Morning, Minister. Thanks very much for that introduction. I am really keen to push the Minister on timetabling and dates, and I suppose it's twofold. Firstly, I would like to hear a clear commitment with some dates or some idea of when things will progress in terms of the overall change in National Care Service and that bill. And secondly, in terms of the implementation, I was listening this morning to the evidence we took in September, and people were saying we do need some actions now, which you have talked about. And it's great that you have allocated funding, and also it was good to hear that your department is indeed very busy, which is excellent. But again, I think it would be important for people to have some kind of actions and some time frame about when these actions may take place. And what actual concrete things are you working on for people to see a difference in the next year of my parliamentary term?
Thank you, convener. And as the committee well knows, I want to commit myself or promise anything unless I know that it can be delivered. And timelines are kind of difficult because we don't know what coronavirus is going to do next. I think, you know, trying to second guess all of this is not an easy thing to do. But what I would say to the committee, as always, I am more than happy to continue to brief the committee on where we are at in all aspects of our work streams as we move forward. In terms of timeline for the bill, we have said that we would introduce the bill by the end of this parliamentary year, so that's June, and we are on track to do that. But again, I would emphasise the fact that it is not all about the bill or the formation of National Care Service, because we know that we have a lot of work to do in terms of ensuring that we get back to some kind of normality, that remobilisation of social care. And the committee will be well aware of the actions that we have already taken, for example, on pay and introducing that minimum £10.50 an hour rate. At this moment in time, we are in discussions with COSLA around about conditions. And I hope that the newly elected members in our local authorities and whoever the new COSLA spokesperson is will continue to engage with us on that. I would put on record, convener, that Stuart Curry, who was the previous spokesperson, who stood down at the election, was extremely cooperative, and I think that we are in a good place with our local authority partners because we both want to achieve the same thing. But we also have to recognise in that front that we're dealing at this moment, and this is one of the big difficulties for me and for those folks in local authorities with 1,200 employers. But we'll continue to try and make gains in that regard. And as I mentioned in my opening speech, one of the other things which I would like to see, and I know COSLA share that ambition, but we have to work our way through this, is, the demise of eligibility criteria for non-residential services. Again, as we have those discussions, those negotiations, and hopefully make progress, we will keep the committee informed of all of this. And at the heart of all of that change, of course, is people and getting it right for people. Not just only the workforce, but also those folks who are being supported and receiving care.
Thank you.
Thanks,
Convener. We'd like to move on and talk about the biggest issue that we hear about regarding the social care workforce. Questions led by David Torrance. David.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, everyone. Minister, what evaluation has the Scottish Government made of the impact of current commission arrangements on social care workforce, and how should they be addressed?
Well, the commissioning aspect is one which is vast in its differences, let's put it that way. I think that would be fair to say. In terms of current commissioning, in different parts of the country, as Mr. Torrance is well aware, not only as an MSP, but being a former local authority member himself, can be vastly different. And what we need to do as we move forward is to make change there. I've put great stock on ethical commissioning as we move forward. I think that is extremely important. We have tried to provide some comfort to local authorities around about changing their commissioning now. And hopefully we can make more progress on that front. But let's look at what the independent review of adult social care said around about current commissioning arrangements. Because what we're trying to achieve is to begin to look at their recommendations and implement some of those already. So I talked about trying to give comfort at this moment. On the 6th of December of last year, the government issued a Scottish procurement policy note, which was co-designed with key stakeholders to advise public bodies involved in the commissioning and procurement of social care services of the action that they can take in the here and now to improve commissioning practice. The government are clear that by taking action now to embed ethical commissioning and procurement principles, we can help public bodies and providers to fully engage in the new and changing responsibilities that will happen with a national care service. And that note includes advice on how to use resources well, to seek to extend or modify contract terms to support transition arrangements, and asks that where a new procurement is required for community health and social care services, that efforts are taken to embed the ethical commissioning and procurement principles that I think that we all want as we move forward.
Minister, you mentioned earlier that there are nearly 1,200 employers, which must be difficult to control, but Audit Scotland highlighted that 20% of workers are not on permanent contracts, 11% are on zero-hour contracts, and 13% work more than 50 hours a week. What's the Minister's view on establishing national minimum standards of pay and conditions for all social care workers, regardless of what sector they work in?
Well, Convener, that's one of the key principles of the National Care Service, to raise those standards and to look at national pay bargaining as we move forward. I am a great believer in fair work. The government is committed to fair work principles that will be embedded in the National Care Service. And I think that one of the reasons why so many of the employers in delivering social care at the moment have difficulties in terms of recruitment and retention is because they are not providing their workers with that fair work. I have seen, and I'm quite sure that many of you will have seen, a situation whereby at this moment in time there is a lot of movement within the social care workforce. And that, in a lot of cases, and who can blame them, is folks who want permanency in terms of a contract, who want higher pay, and who want better conditions. So at this moment, those good employers out there, and there are good employers out there, without doubt, are actually gaining the benefits from the pay and conditions that they offer. And, some of the employers who are not living up to the principles of fair work are losing employees. Now, a lot of that is, at the moment, fishing from the same pool, which is a difficult situation, which, may resolve a tension in one area, but actually causes one in another. Now, that scenario, I hope that we can iron out as we move forward with fair work, with national pay bargaining. And I think the other thing for me as we move forward in terms of attracting particularly young people to social care and to social work is that we have got to show young folk how they can progress in their careers within social care and social work. And that is not so easy at this moment in time. But we have had discussions with the likes of NHS Education Scotland, the Open University and others to look to see how better we can provide training qualifications, pardon me, and education to make those progressions easier. And we know that during the course of their careers, some folk will want to flip jobs. It may well be that folks may want to go from social care to the health service or to social work or vice versa. And sometimes that's not so easy at this moment, and we need to make that easier. In order to grow this workforce for the future, we have to make it much more attractive, particularly for young people. And that career progression, those career pathways, are immensely important as we move forward too.
Minister, Audit Scotland highlighted the 5.1% vacancy rate in the sector. How difficult has Brexit and UK immigration policy made it for employers to recruit staff in this area?
It has made matters for many very, very difficult. Some of you around the chamber will have heard me say before that in conversation with one employer in one of their facilities, they lost 40%, 40%, of their workforce after Brexit, where folks chose to return home because of what happened, because of the feeling of the hostile environment. That has a real impact in terms of service delivery. And I think, you know, some folk have said that we over-egg the pudding when it comes to talking about Brexit, but that is a prime example of the real impact that Brexit had on service delivery. Now, while I'm not saying that every service lost 40% of their staff, you know, there are tales from right across Scotland where you know, folk have talked about the real impact of people returning to their home countries because they didn't feel welcome in the UK anymore. Now, I know that we have done our level best to try and reassure folk that they're welcome here in Scotland, but we lost a lot of people, good people, who were delivering for our most vulnerable.
Questions on this from Sue Webber. Sue.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. A couple of things I've got to ask you, Minister, and thanks very much for coming along. Nice to meet your team face-to-face at last. You spoke about discussions with COSLA. So I was wondering that when you're doing that procurement and commissioning exercise, you know, is there scope to include minimum pay terms and conditions built? Could that be built into the procurement and commissioning to allow us to help the workforce in terms of that?
I would hope, Ms Webber, in terms of the comfort that we have provided with the procurement note that I talked about earlier, that we can move to that ethical commissioning, which actually has Fair Work at its heart as well. You know, we have drafted procurement rules here in Scotland in a way that enables collaboration and discourages competition based on price. They enable preliminary, shouldn't have even attempted to say that, Convener, market engagement with providers before starting a tender process, and prevent a public contract being awarded on the basis of price alone. You know, we want to see high standards here. We want to see a situation where Fair Work is at the very heart of all that we do. That is vital as we move forward. Now, you know, there are some folks who say that it is difficult to do that in terms of current procurement rules. Those folks are more than willing to have conversations with my team or with the procurement team here to give them comfort on how they should move forward in that front towards ethical procurement.
Thanks very much, Convener. Thank you, Minister. I think I'm leading on the next session on commissioning, so I'll not
drill any further, but I've got one more on workforce, if that's okay.
Yeah, I was going to say, Sue, I mean, we have mentioned commission already, so if you want to go to your commission question...
I've got one more on the workforce, and then...
Okay, and then we'll need to take questions from others that want to talk about workforce, but just to let colleagues know, a lot of you want to ask about workforce, so if you can keep your questions short. So, Sue, if you carry on.
We have, you've mentioned the issue about retention and recruitment in terms of the workforce, with a quarter of staff in the care sector leaving within the first 3 months of joining an organisation. What more can be done to stop that from happening and keep those people in these roles?
Convener, I kind of touched upon this earlier because, you know, it is absolutely right that folk, you know, take opportunities if they are getting better terms and conditions to move on. And a lot of folk who are in the social care profession may be moving on after a period of time, but are staying within the social care profession, but getting better terms and conditions. Again, you know, for those employers who at the moment, whose conditions are not the best, they should be looking at that, because at the end of the day, every time they lose a member of staff, that is costing them in terms of recruitment costs and many other costs. So it would be in their interest to act now in terms of improving their pay and conditions. Convener, I can't remember off the top of my head what the number was, but CCPS, you know, did a calculation not so long ago around about the cost of constant recruitment. And we can provide the committee, I hope, with that figure. But it wasn't insubstantial. Now, rather than forking out that constant money in recruitment for some employers, it may be best that they actually, you know, invest and put that in to pay and improving conditions, and then, you know, they may be able to retain a lot more of their staff. I should say, convener, once again, and I'll probably caveat this a few times, you know, there are employers out there who are paying their staff well, with good conditions, and they are retaining their people.
Paul. Can I move to commissioning? Or is it still workforce? Sorry.
Well, it depends on the questions you've got. If you've got lots of questions in commission, I'll come back to you. If it's just one then that's fine.
Thank you very much. We've heard speaking about ethical commissioning of care, and we've also know that right now, sadly, the services are commissioned and the people are almost shoehorned into what's available and what services are there rather than it being developed for them. So how can we turn the commissioning on its head to make the individual the centre of the decision-making rather than it being as it is now?
Convener, in all that we do, whether it's the work of the government, the work of IJBs, local authorities, or NHS boards in all of this, we have to listen more to the voices of lived experience. Let me be quite frank with the committee. You know, some of the work that we are doing at this moment in time would not have been at the forefront of our minds, but, you know, are issues that have been brought to us by folks with lived experience. You know, one of the key things for me around about the National Care Service is ensuring that as we move forward, the voices of lived experience play a real part in shaping services. Now, I'm going to be maybe a little bit controversial here, convener, not like me, I know. But, you know, it's 10 years since I left local government, a decade. And, you know, looking at procurement now from this place rather than from the local authority side, I can see some real changes that have happened over the piece in certain places. And one of the frustrations that I have, and it's certainly a frustration for those who are supported and receive care is the fact that often in recent times, in terms of the formulation of the tender and the contract, there has been more involvement from the likes of accountants and the legal boards than there has been from frontline social care staff or from those folks who are receiving care. We need to turn that around in its head, quite frankly.
Thank you. Paul?
Thank you, convener, and good morning to the minister. In evidence to the Public Audit Committee, the Auditor General said that we know that the social care workforce has been under immense pressure during the pandemic, and that was spoken about by the Minister in his opening. Indeed, the Auditor General went on to say that that was the case even before the pandemic. And in those remarks, the Auditor General also said that the Scottish Government needs to take action to improve working conditions for this vitally important workforce, otherwise it will not be able to deliver its ambitions longer term in terms of social care. And I think the Audit Scotland report actually has outlined what those pressures are and what those challenges are, and it's clear that there's an immediacy and a need to resolve some of those. But I'm also interested in the exacerbation of those issues due to the cost of living crisis. You know, it's very clear that many of these workers, very often women, very often lower paid workers, are struggling to make ends meet and are actually struggling to be able to do the job that they're in. And that's because of rising costs of getting to work, getting between their shifts, getting public transport or in their car. So what's the Minister's assessment of what needs to be done immediately to deal with some of that?
Okay, there's a fair amount in there, convener. First of all, I would highlight the point that the government has, in the last year, raised pay twice for social care staff, with a minimum pay being £10.50 an hour from April of this year. And that is an increase of 12.9% for the workforce, for those workers over the course of the year, which is much greater than that south of the border and much higher than what has happened in Wales. And I agree with Mr O'Kane that the cost of living crisis is having an impact on everyone, including folk in the social care workforce. And I would appeal to the UK government, to the Chancellor of the Exchequer, to get the finger out, get on with an emergency budget, and ensure that we are doing our level best for individuals and families right across the country who are being impacted by the rise in fuel prices, the rise in energy costs, and the rise in their weekly shop. So my appeal is, Chancellor, get the finger out and take some action there. In terms of the specific that Mr. O'Kane talked about in terms of transportation costs and mileage, I would highlight the point that there are 1,200 employers out there. The government is not the employer here. 1,200 employers. They need to step up to the plate as well. We, the government, don't set the mileage rates paid to social care staff, as they're agreed and set by their own employers. However, what I would say to Mr. O'Kane, convener, and to the committee is that we are actively engaged with our partners, including local government, to understand what the impact the increase in fuel prices is having across Scotland and how social care providers can support their staff through this period to ensure that they can continue to deliver the invaluable support that they provide. We as a government have a long-standing commitment to the principles of fair work for the social care sector. And we are fully committed to improving the experience of that workforce, including, as I pointed out, increasing the levels of pay, and as we move forward, delivering consistent fair work conditions to staff working within social care in Scotland. But there's not a lot that I can do, Mr. O'Kane. There's not a lot of power. There's no power that I have to push the 1,200 employers into some actions. But the committee can be assured that we will continue that active engagement with local government to see how we could move forward on that front.
A number of other colleagues wanting to come in on the workforce. Stephanie, do you still have a question on this? Yes.
Yes. Thanks, Convener, and good to see you this morning, Minister. The 2019 Fair Work Convention report, the recommendations in that kind of went way beyond paying conditions. And I'm wondering, are you able to provide us with some examples or some information around future plans of how you're going to really involve social care workers in the design, the development and the delivery?
Okay. I think, you know, there's a lot going on in terms of fair work as part of our ongoing work in setting minimum standards across both pay and conditions as we move forward. The Fair Work and Social Care Group, which we established, will continue to explore across the entire spectrum of social care work. The work of the Fair Work Group and Social Care Group is critical, and we're working on the objectives as agreed with the group at the start of last year. I understand, and I'm going to look to my right and to my left here, just to see if I'm right, that the Fair Work and Social Care Steering Group are meeting tomorrow, is that right, to agree new priorities moving forward. If it's not tomorrow, I'll correct myself later. Very soon, we'll say, very soon, to look at the new priorities. And as I've already pointed out earlier, we're taking action now with partners and local government in the sector to accelerate improvements, including, as I've highlighted already, the levels of pay. We're also in discussions with COSLA about how we will take forward the next steps on workforce developments. And members may be aware that COSLA leaders took a paper to their final meeting of the last local government session on these issues. And we will revisit that with the new and reinvigorated COSLA as we move forward, as they appoint the new leadership and spokespeople. We are fully committed to working in partnership with trade union staff and providers as we go on, including in areas like the focus on recruitment, on looking at leadership at all levels, pay, terms and conditions, learning and development, as I've touched upon earlier, and career pathways. And we will specifically focus on the commission sector in the first instance, but will reach across the whole of adult social care. So I'm sorry if I'm going on too long, but I was specific around about the 2019 Fair Work report. From that, and as part of our commitments there, we are ensuring that we move forward in terms of effective voice within the workplaces. We have included the requirement to consider effective voice measures as part of Fair Work First procurement guidance. And this includes having appropriate channels such as trade union recognition. Convener, I could go on at great length about this, but you're probably going to stop me.
Yeah, I'm going to stop you because we've got one more question on workforce, but I think it will be probably bleeding into quite a lot of our questions anyway. Sandesh Gilhani, and then we'll move on to be talking about our next theme, which I've forgotten.
Thank you, Convener. Morning, Minister. Let me give you an example, but unfortunately this example is all too common, and it's from a Home Help staff member. And she told me she gets 15 minutes per client, and she uses the term client, as do quite a lot, in fact, everyone in this sector, not patient, but client. And this 15 minutes that she gets is for personal care. She gets to put food in the microwave. She gets to give medication, pills that are required, and basically do everything except give that personal touch, the sit down and holding of hand and just a gentle chat with the person, and that might be their only contact of that day with another human. And then she's in a huge rush to get out to the next client, as this is not allocated time. And now let's look at what the other side of that coin is, the patient perspective. And the patient tells me that they feel rushed. They feel as though there is no time for them, and they feel as though they are a burden. And this is an example, but actually this is commonplace and throughout our social care workforce. If both sides are saying this, is it acceptable? And secondly, I'm assuming you're going to say no, it's not. How can we improve this so that in the short term, we can do things for people and not wait for these big changes to occur?
So I think there are a number of things there. First of all, I would say that rushed example is not a good one either for the person working in care or for the person who is being supported. And while, you know, I have had exactly the same examples as Dr. Gilhani, I also have other examples of where it works well for both the folks who are working in the sector and those who are receiving support and care. And I think what we need to do is to look at those good examples and export them right across the board. So let me give you probably the best example that I've come across, where I recently met with the Aberdeen Granite Care Consortium, which is a group of third and independent sector organisations who came together to bid for a home care contract in Aberdeen. And during the course of the pandemic period, they have done which I hope that others will follow, and I've been encouraging others to follow suit, whereby they have given their frontline staff the independence and autonomy to step up or step down care to meet the needs of the folk that they are supporting. Now, as Dr. Gilhani, convener of the committee, will understand, there is more stepping up of care than stepping down of care. But that person-centred approach with the independence given to the person in the know, who is the person who is going in on a day and daily basis often, who can see the needs of a person, is, in my opinion, the right way forward. That independence and autonomy of the frontline staff is what we should have more of. Now, some would say, you know, what difference does that make? What evidence can you provide in terms of the difference that that can make? Well, we know, convener, that we have some difficulties in terms of delayed discharge across the country. In some areas, delayed discharge rates are much higher than in others. And Dr. Gilhani will know from his medical experience, the best way of stopping delayed discharge is, of course, to keep people out of hospital in the first place and provide for their needs at home, if that is at all possible. Now, if you look at delayed discharge in Aberdeen, for example, Delayed discharge there, as at the 26th of April, stood at 19, which is very, very low compared to many other parts of the country, and is particularly low compared to the other cities. And I think that the work that has gone on there by the Granite Care Consortium and others has meant, you know, with that flexibility, stepping up care where it's required, has meant that less folk, fewer folk, have had to go into hospital. So that flexibility, that autonomy to the front line, that level of understanding of meeting the needs of folk, I think makes a real difference, and that's what we need to be doing as we move forward.
Comes back to what the issues about STS as well and the flexibility of the care. So we're going to move on to talking about retention of senior leaders. Emma Harper.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister, and to your officials also. So a couple of questions about leadership. In the Audit Scotland report, it talks about the health and social care sector needs stable and collaborative leadership to address the ongoing challenges. And we've had evidence previously at a previous health committee talking about how we support leaders, and I know the Scottish Government can lead on leadership, so I'd be interested to hear what the Scottish Government is doing to help support and address the challenges for retaining senior leaders in social care.
Convener, I think, you know, as always, there are always challenges in terms of retaining some folk. And the government places great importance upon its relationship with senior health and social care leaders. My officials meet with regularly with Integration Joint Board chief officers. And I have been meeting chief officers on almost a monthly basis since I took office. And those meetings cover a wide range of topics, including leadership development and barriers to integration. Officials met with the executive group of chief officers recently to discuss further support that might be required, whether that's more capacity to provide peer support and learning, coaching and mentoring for individuals, or more structured programmes of support. We have also discussed engagement with wider staff groups to encourage participation in local and national strategic activity with succession planning in mind. I think, you know, the meetings that we have with chief officers also give them the ability to articulate what they are doing well and where they're having difficulties, and there is that peer support as well, which I think is extremely important, and which at some points in the pandemic, you know, folk have felt that there hasn't been enough time for that. So I think all of these things are important as we move forward. And, you know, I think my role in all of this as well is to listen to what is being said by chief officers, what the barriers are that exist there are for them, see if we can get rid of those barriers, but also, you know, to provide a forum to bring folk together to provide the support that that is required.
And I suppose if we're talking about peer support, during the pandemic, obviously everybody worked really, really hard, and there's a lot of pressure, a lot of emotional stress and fatigue. So is it part of that peer support is to look at developing resilience among the leadership and look at how we're going to expand the pool and be more inclusive to I suppose, to procure more people into leadership positions as well?
I think, you know, resilience is a part of this. There's absolutely no doubt about it. But also, you know, in terms of some of the discussions that have been had, you know, a lot of the focus has been on how are we all supporting one another during what has been very difficult and stressful times for many, many of us. So there have been lots of discussions around about the mental wellbeing hub support that we've put in place, for example. There have been examples of good practice in terms of mental wellbeing support that have happened at a local level, which have been talked about within that national group, which folk have then moved on to implementing in their own areas. So, you know, that coming together, that period to talk about these things, I think can often be not only good learning, but also can be quite cathartic. Because I think during some points during the past period, that many of us at points have felt maybe a little bit alone. You know, this is happening to me, but, you know, when you talk to others, you find, you know, similar position. And then how do we help one another through all of that?
Just about the...
To move on to talk about data.
OK. Annie Gunnar-Logan talked about citizen leadership when she gave us evidence. So that's kind of what you're talking about, where you identify people with lived experience, people who are unpaid carers or who are using care services. So is there any work that the Scottish Government is doing to promote or enable citizen leadership? Is that something that's been taken forward?
Well, if you look at the work that we've done in terms of the Social Covenant Steering Group, I would say that that's citizen leadership. But it's not just at that level with those folks who will be helping us co-design NCS as we move forward. We, not just government, but the public sector as a whole, as we move forward here, need to listen to the voices of the very articulate, experienced folk out there who know how the system works. They know what works well, but they also know where the system does not work, where there has been failure for many of them. We need to listen to people as we move forward in order to shape the right care system for all as we move forward.
Thank you. Thanks, Convener.
Sandesh, you've got questions around records and data.
Absolutely. Thank you, Convener. Minister, data, we always seem to come back to data. It is vital for anything that we do, especially if we are looking forwards to make changes. So I've got two real questions to ask about it. One of the messages we got from Audit Scotland was that an unwillingness or inability to share information along with a lack of relevant data means there are major gaps in the information needed to inform improvements in social care. With that being the case, what data are you looking at and how are you responding to Audit Scotland for your push forward for a National Care Service if we don't have this information?
Convener, I think I've been quite frank in terms of some of the answers I've given previously on data, particularly to Ms Mackay in the Chamber, who has been pretty vociferous in asking numerous questions in that front. We have implemented a data improvement programme that, working together with local and national partners, which should challenge the issues around about social care data quality and consistency, and the issues that exist with data sharing, and address gaps such as unmet need, workforce data and modelling future demand. That programme is developing and I'm more than willing to come back to the committee or to inform the committee of the work of the improvement work that is going on in the short to medium term. We have got to get this right in terms of the transition to the National Care Service. And as part of that work, we have been working with Public Health Scotland, IJBs, NHS boards and local authorities to improve management information on pressures in the health and social care system. And this will enable us to respond collectively to pressures and issues arising, as well as improving planning for the future. I think the other aspect of this, convener, which is vitally important, is our proposals in terms of the national care record itself, because one of the key issues for many people accessing care is the amount of times that they have to repeat their story, which is often very frustrating, can often be triggering, because they're having to repeat difficult stories again and again. And, you know, the national care record, I think, will make a real difference in terms of ensuring that we get it right for people as we move forward. More than happy, as we move forward, convener, to continue to update the committee on what we're doing to improve data.
And that, Sandesh, have you anything else before
yes,
you want
yes,
to cover?
Yes, I do. And so just before moving, I just would like to know if you could just let me know briefly about the timeline for that data that you have just told us about the work.
Convener, I will write to the committee with indicative timelines. You know, I don't want to be specific about any of this because, as the committee will be well aware, this is a ever-moving feast, and I'm also, as my officials are, reliant on other partners in all of this. But we'll give you indicative timelines.
Thank you.
Just my last question, again on data. And so the consultation for the National Care Service, in the report, many respondents highlighted issues as to the length of the questionnaire, the short space of time in which they could prepare a response, the lack of detail around proposals, the nature of some of the questions which were thought to be leading the respondents to a particular answer. And looking at it, feedback, 33% of feedback of respondents said they were dissatisfied with the consultation process. So with that being the case, again, data is important. So with the consultation, with this type of feedback, how do you respond to that and how do we go forward to ensure that we get the information that we want?
So, you know, there are lots of different views around about the National Care Service consultation, and I think it would be fair to say, convener, that I've heard them all. Some folk thought that the consultation was too long. Some folk thought that the consultation was too short. Others felt that some of the questions that they wanted to see were not there, and, you know, the list goes on. But the consultation itself, that NCS consultation, is not the end of the engagement here. And I have made it very clear right from the very beginning of all of this that as we move forward, we must continue to talk to, listen to, consult with stakeholders, and in particular the voices of lived experience, in order for us to get this absolutely right. And that's why, convener, you know, this work will continue throughout. It will work as the bill progresses. It will go on beyond the bill as we are shaping NCS, because it's not just about the legislation or the regulation. It is also about the cultural change that's required too. This is going to continue to be engagement all the way through. You know, I have said to this committee time and time again, and I'll probably continue to do it as we move forward, I am very keen. We need to hear the voices of lived experience as we shape social care for the future.
Okay. Move on to talking about financial planning and everything that you've talked about today, whether it's National Care Service or the improvements that you're currently making. Stephanie Callaghan.
Thank you, Convener. So I think, Minister, we've known for quite a long time, you know, we've looked at the Christie report, etc., there as well, that there really needs to be that shift from critical care to preventative care. I think that's something that we can all probably agree on, actually. And what I'm wondering is, you know, have we looked into the level of unmet needs and what it would cost to meet those needs, rather than just looking at meeting substantial and critical needs just now? And in reality as well, you know, is there a greater cost in not meeting those needs from a preventative point of view and keeping people well?
Convener, crisis costs a lot of money. And there's also the human cost of not dealing with things early. And I think that the move to the preventative approach will save a lot of money that can be reinvested and also stop some of the human costs of not getting this right. We know, because we can hear it from people themselves, where the focus has been on prevention, that has been much better for people and is over the piece much less costly on the public purse. And you know, it's very difficult for me to relay stories because I don't really want to identify people, which is always a danger. But you know, having heard stories of folks who have moved from a situation where it was almost constant crisis to a situation where self-directed support has worked for them, which means that, you know, crisis is very rare now, that makes the odds, you know, for folks, and it is less costly. So I think, you know, as we move forward, we've got to analyse, and we will, of course, carry out tests of change to see what the impacts, the financial impacts are on these changes. But, you know, I think beyond doubt, just listening to the day-to-day stories of people's lives, that move to prevention lessens the difficulties that folk have, you know, stops some of the horror stories that we have all heard, and, you know, is much less costly than crisis intervention, which costs a lot.
So just kind of following on from that then, I think you gave a really good example earlier on when you talked about Granite Care Consortium, hopefully I've got that right there, and about frontline staff being able to step up care to prevent getting into hospital, as well as step down care as well. So I'm wondering as well, you know, if we're going to be looking at really investing in the preventative side of things, how do we look at measuring the effectiveness of that and actually building the evidence so that we're able to deliver that right across the board nationally?
I think one of the things, Ms. Callaghan, is that sometimes it's difficult. Sometimes it is very difficult to build that evidence case, because I've given the example of, you know, that step up, step down care that's happening. But could I tell you in the here and now, could the folk in Aberdeen tell you in the here and now how many folk they prevented from going into hospital? That's a very difficult thing to do, you know. It is not so easy to work out what that stepping up has or hasn't done. What we do know is that it has been helpful for people. And, you know, I think we can make the broad assumption and wouldn't be far off the mark that it has probably saved a lot of folk from going in that hospital front door. And, you know, it's one of the reasons for the lower number of delayed discharges in Aberdeen compared to many other parts, well, many other of our cities. So I think, you know, sometimes this is, particularly in the short term, very difficult to measure. But, you know, I think broad assumptions would not be off the mark in terms of the fact that that is helpful in terms of keeping folk out of acute services.
It was just a really short question to finish up there. Has there been any kind of work or interest in looking at maybe having a kind of dashboard of wellbeing indicators where we're actually getting the feedback from individuals on how they're doing? And I'm stealing this from Education Committee that I'm also on as well, because data, again, coming back to the evidence, can be just so hard to measure and it can be so difficult to get that information. But I'm wondering if that's something you've looked at or something you would consider taking a wee look at in the future.
Well, I'm not afraid of pinching, stealing, plagiarising, Ms Callaghan. I think what I would say to you is we all have a look at that dashboard that Education are using and have a look at that and consider whether that will be useful to us as we move forward.
It is a work in progress. Okay. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We are going to give over the remaining time we have for questions from colleagues around the National Care Service, which of course is inevitably peppered everything we've talked about so far. It's in the backdrop of everything we're talking about. Those questions are going to be led by Gillian Mackay.
Thanks, Convener, and good morning, Minister. One of the criticisms of the public consultation on the NCS was that there needs to be more public engagement and more involvement from clients and people accessing care and support. I know we've touched on this a lot already this morning, but how does the Minister respond to this, and what work is being done to ensure that more people are involved during the consultation and implementation process going forward?
We continue to listen to folk as we move forward, and I gave the example of my meeting yesterday, and I'll continue to do that, and officials are continuing that on a day and daily basis. What may be useful for the committee is that we can provide you with an idea of what has gone on maybe in the last month or two, from my perspective, but also from the official's perspective. I'd say that there has been, well, some folk have said, oh, you've been quite quiet during the course of the pre-election period, and obviously there are various things that we can't say there, but even during that time, you know, we have continued to talk to stakeholders, to listen to stakeholders, and to take on board what they have to say. And again, at the very heart of all of that is listening to the voices of lived experience, which is the key thing as far as I'm concerned.
One of the other issues that was raised by respondents to the consultation was that the paper focused on organisational restructuring and didn't focus so much on the transformative cultural change which is needed, which prioritises person-centred services. What's the Minister's response to this, and how will you ensure that structural change is matched by the cultural change that's needed?
Well, I think we often hear concentrate on the legislation and the regulation. And, you know, sometimes it is difficult to legislate or regulate for cultural change. But we know that we have a job of work to do in terms of changing culture, particularly in certain areas, and I don't mean by that geographic areas necessarily. And I think one of the main ways that we change the culture is to make sure that the voices of lived experience remain at the heart of all that we do, not only at a national level, but also at that local level as well. And that is why I am very, very keen to ensure that the voices of lived experience have a role and a vote on care boards. And I hope that that will come to fruition. I think that that will change the dynamic a great deal. Now, I know that in many, many parts of the country, folks with lived experience are already at the table. But, you know, I want them at the table with a vote, because I think that will make a real difference in terms of cultural change.
That's me, Convener. Thanks.
Thank you, Gillian. Evelyn, you have some questions on this.
Thanks, Convener. Good morning, Minister. The Scottish Government published an analysis of stakeholders' responses in the NCS consultation, which showed 77% of respondents felt that the main benefit of the National Care Service was taking responsibility for improvement across community health and care services and would mean more consistent outcomes for people. Is the Minister confident that there will be more consistent outcomes for people, and can this be achieved?
Yes, I think it can be achieved, and you know that's the reason for doing all of this. The postcode lottery has had a real impact on some folk, and it's quite bizarre because, and I think I've maybe touched upon this before in committee, even within local authority health and social care partnership areas, within those areas there can be differences in service delivery, which can be really frustrating for people. And I think I maybe gave an example from your constituency previously, convener, where you know somebody who lived in your constituency was absolutely and completely and utterly annoyed at the fact that service delivery for them was so much different from Peterhead, which is not in your constituency, and that's within the same local authority area, within the same health and social care partnership area. So my confidence in terms of that service delivery improving and getting it right for all is down to the fact of bringing in those national quality care standards, so that you know the folks who are delivering and supporting people know what is expected of them, and the folks who are being supported know what they should expect as they move forward. I think, you know, for probably everyone around this table, those inconsistencies in delivery of service has probably led to a fair amount of correspondence in your mailbags and inboxes. We need to get rid of that. That's one of the main reasons for doing it. And I'm confident that if we will get these national care standards right and create a fairer situation for all. I should also say that, you know, some people have argued that, you know, the standards in their area are already the best. And, you know, they feel that, you know, NCS may pull that back. We will be aspiring to reaching those highest standards as we move on.
Evelyn, Paul.
Thank you, Convener. Audit Scotland are particularly concerned around or interested in the learning that can be taken from previous public sector reform. And I think I've highlighted in their analysis that very often expected benefits are not always clearly defined. And even where they are, they're not always delivered, and particularly in that kind of short-term period. So how confident is the Minister that the benefits have been defined and can go on to be delivered?
Well, I think, you know, we have given a really good outline of what we want to do here in terms of defining benefits. Who are we defining the benefits for? For the public service itself, for people, you know, the list goes on. I think we need to continue to work and defining what all of those benefits are. You know, we will continue to analyse all of that as we go forward. I think the key thing for me in all about in all of this, and you know, we can go back to Christy, is looking at that joined up approach, getting rid of the silos that unfortunately still exist, and no matter what is in or what is out of National Care Service, making those transition phases much better for people. That's a major benefit in getting that right. So I think there's a huge amount that will benefit people without a doubt, a huge amount that will benefit the public sector as a whole. We will continue to work in all of that, and I'm quite sure that Mr. O'Kane will continue to scrutinise whether those benefits become a reality or not. But I am very hopeful, you know, that we will make some real change here, particularly for the good of folks.
I wonder if I can. I certainly will. I think scrutiny is the job of all of us to get this right. I wonder if I can just perhaps scrutinise in terms of those benefits and the understanding of those benefits. I think for those who responded to the consultation, I think we've heard already that the government's own analysis acknowledges that there were quite a large number of criticisms in the consultation process in all formats of submission. And two of the principal reasons given were complexity of the issues and the lack of detail in the proposal. So would the Minister accept that perhaps those defined benefits that we've just talked about, you know, that people perhaps are struggling to engage and understand what those are? And I know in his previous answer he's committed to that further engagement work, but I think it's very clear that people want to see that detail and that continued conversation.
I think, Mr. O'Kane talked about the complexity of the consultation. Other folks said it wasn't complex enough, and I recognise that folks always want more detail, but at the same time, when there was detail in the consultation, some folks said, well, you've already made up your mind on that particular issue. So you kind of win sometimes in these regards, but I think where folk do recognise where the government is going with all of this, there's a recognition by most stakeholders out there that, the consultation is only one part of this. And we will continue to discuss with stakeholders and the voices of lived experience around about where we need to go here, including the discussion around about the benefits as we move forward. This is going to be beneficial for all. I'm absolutely convinced of that. And we need to grasp the opportunity here to get this right, to ensure that we are doing the right thing in shaping the future of social care in Scotland.
Evelyn, you wanted to pick up on something? And then I'll come to Sundesh. Okay.
How many people has the Scottish Government estimated could benefit from care where it's not in place now?
Gosh. Now, I have that number somewhere, I think, but whether I can... Oh, Miss Bell is much more on the ball than I am. Right, the Independent Review on Adult Social Care estimated that approximately 36,000 people do not have access to social care support at this moment, people who would benefit from access to the support. So 36,000 people is the number.
Okay, thank you for that.
Thank you. Sandesh.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, I'm truly concerned with the recommendations that new community health and social care boards would be in charge of GP contractual arrangements. Integration is important, but with a few exceptions, the HSCPs have failed to really engage well with practices. The GP contract is a national, not a local one.
This is social care that we're talking about, not GP practices. I'm just not entirely sure we're asking the right person about this. Have you got a social care aspect to this?
So this is in the national care consultation. Uh-huh,
okay.
The BMA, through the Scottish GP Committee, have said that they were not consulted on this recommendation. And that they're against it, and I believe the RCGP are against it as well. So my question would be, why would you want to make the changes, and what benefits do you envisage with these changes being made?
Convener, we have asked a number of questions in the consultation to get the views of stakeholders, including the likes of the BMA, but also the views of the folks with lived experience there. What I would say to Dr. Gohani is at this moment there has been no decision taken around about that move.
I'm sorry for my confusion there. I just thought you were going on to GP contracts, and I thought it was maybe better for the Cabinet Secretary, but I apologise if I got that wrong. We've got a final question from Sue Webber.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, you mentioned earlier, Minister, that your intention is to increase the spending on social care for the length of this Parliament by 25%. So I'm just looking to find out where that money is coming from, given there is the new money, in inverted commas, from the National Insurance Consequentials, which could be up to £1 billion. So I'm just wondering if that money was intended to be ring-fenced and might be over and above that 25%.
We have committed to that enhancement of £800 million. What I would say to Ms Webber, and maybe she can be helpful here for the Scottish Government, is we have had no indication from the UK Treasury around about what we are likely to get in terms of that national insurance rise. So if Ms Webber wants to have a word in the shell like of Rishi Sunak to see how Scotland will benefit and we finally get some numbers out of him, then maybe I would be in a better position to answer that question. But we've committed to that £800 million, Convener.
Emma, you want to come in before we let the Minister go?
Yep. Just a quick question. It's in... just reflecting on what Sandesh Gulhani has asked you about questions that have been asked in the consultation. I think, is it right, though, that we ask difficult questions sometimes in order to elicit what would be maybe out-of-the-box thinking or different changes or new ways of working? Would that not be the processes that we would follow to ask questions sometimes that folk might not like?
Absolutely, and a lot of the questions that were within the consultation were suggestions and views from those voices of lived experience. That's the way that consultations work. We do actually ask some difficult questions, and it has to be said that in terms of the GP contract aspect of this, that was actually a direct recommendation from the independent review by Derek Feely. So others would have said that if we hadn't asked that question, that we ignored a Feely recommendation.
Thank you very much. I want to thank the Minister and Ms Bell and Ms Barclay for their time this morning. We'll just have a very short suspension while we allow the Minister and his officials to leave.
Thank you.
Thank you. Right, colleagues. Our third item on our agenda is consideration of a negative instrument, and that instrument is the Genetically Modified Food and Feed Authorisation Scotland Regulations 2022. And this instrument authorises five new types of genetically modified maize and soybean products for use in food and animal feed sold in Scotland. It also renews authorisation for continuing use of four genetically modified maize products. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee considered this instrument at its meeting on the 10th of May 2022 and agreed to draw this instrument to the attention of Parliament under the general reporting ground in respect of an error in paragraphs 4, brackets 2 of schedules 3, 4 and 7. And the document reference number is incorrectly stated to be EURLVL0417VP rather than EURLVL03/12VP. In response to correspondence from the DPLR committee, the Scottish Government acknowledged that there is a referencing error in the instrument but does not propose to correct this. So no motions to annul have been received in relation to this instrument. Do any members have any comments they wish to make? Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Convener. The Genetically Modified Food and Feed Authorisation Scotland Regulations 2022 authorise 9 GM food and feed products, making them available for consumption in Scotland. The Scottish Greens have long-standing concerns over the environmental impact of genetically modified crops that are not properly addressed in these regulations, and our concern is that our status as a GM-free country is being eroded by this decision. I would also like to note a strong concern over the constitutional implications of this and indeed other decisions over GM products. Scotland should have the power to make the decisions it sees fit to protect the environment and the public, but the reality is that it doesn't matter what decision we make here today over these regulations or any future authorisations for GM food or feed, because even if we were to withhold authorisation, this would have no material impact because the UK has already allowed access to these products, and due to the UK Internal Market Act, the Scottish Parliament could not choose a different path.
Okay, thank you. That's on the record. Does anyone else want to make any comments in relation to this instrument? Okay. So, we propose that the committee itself does not make any recommendations in relation to this instrument, notwithstanding that Gillian Mackay has put her views on the record. Does any member disagree with this? Okay. I don't have any disagreement at all. At our next meeting on the 24th of May, the committee will begin taking evidence as part of our inquiry into health inequalities. And that concludes the public part of our meeting today. Thank you, everyone.